Good morning, Broadway. Welcome to worship on this fifth Sunday of Easter. The early Christian community knew they needed one another, every single person, and they shared with one another. I bet you've seen a lot of that sharing over the last few weeks. People sharing with each other material resources, friendship, and all sorts of attempts to stay connected. This is what it means to be human. This is what it means to be Christian. To be needed. To need one another. What better time to be reminded of that than this Mother's Day? Let us worship God.
If you have a candle, light it. It reminds us of God's presence, Christ's presence, when we feel lost and we don't know where to turn next. It reminds us that there is still hope, even in our darkest hours, even when it's pitch black outside and we don't know what to do or where to turn. So light a candle. Let us gather together today.
Bondage again, you just stay. just stay.
Today's scripture reading is from Acts 2, verse 42 through 47. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all, as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. Thanks be to God.
Every Sunday we have what we call here the lesson from the contemporary church. It's a time when we remind ourselves that God didn't stop speaking when the book went to press, but continues to write in our own lives and stories. This morning, we welcome Ashley Elliott to bring the first lesson for the contemporary church, and the second one will be brought by Dominic and Rhonda Moses. Welcome to all of you, and thank you.
Hey friends, my name is Ashley Elliott, and I'm excited to get to tell you a little bit today about some positive things that have come out of this time of quarantine for us. If you don't know me already, my husband Spencer and I usually attend the later service at church because I normally sing in the choir. We've been married for, it'll be 8 years in September, and have been coming to Broadway for almost 2 years now. Became members there fairly recently. I grew up in St. Louis, and then we moved to southern Indiana to a very small town partway into my childhood. So I feel like I have an appreciation for both urban and rural life and the perspectives that come with those different ways of living. And I'm really thankful for that upbringing. So what I want to tell you a little bit about today is some of the ways that we've begun to connect with neighbors in new ways through quarantine. One of the things I've really reflected on a lot over these last couple of months is how much I have to be thankful for that my husband Spencer and I are in a safe home, that we're still friends and love hanging out with each other through all this, so we don't feel as alone as other folks probably do. And we're both able to work from home, so we still have steady paychecks coming in. So it's really best case scenario for us. But I don't know that that's true of all the people immediately around me. So while we've taken time to check in with our friends and our relatives who we know are in different situations, I wanted to also reach out to the people that live right around us, people that we could physically help very easily if there was something that they needed, but that previously just didn't have any way to know that. We haven't really taken the time before to get to know the people around us on any sort of a significant level. So I started fairly safely by reaching out and writing notes to the couple of neighbors just immediately around us who we already know fairly well. And interact with normally, and just seeing if there's anything they needed, making sure they had our cell phone numbers. And through that, started to get to know them better and started to learn new things we had in common and different ways that we could support each other through this. And so then as I started to look kind of past those houses, I realized I knew nothing about people, you know, two or three houses down from me even. So I pulled out the giant box of stationery that I have that I never seem to actually use and started to write just short notes to people that live up and down our block, introducing ourselves, telling them a little bit about us, making sure they had our cell phone numbers, asking if there was anything at all that they might need during this time. And then the last thing that I've been including recently, because I am still actively writing notes to more people, and trying to kind of expand up and down this block, the people that we know and have connected with. I've started adding, we're going to be doing a neighborhood cleanup day next Saturday. And so I've started inviting people to come meet at our house in the early afternoon. And then we're going to hand out some trash bags and gloves and go around and kind of clean up our neighborhood if you've spent, we live over on Capitol, just a couple blocks away from the Children's Museum, and if you've spent time in this neighborhood, on that block, or any of the couple around it, you know there's a lot of garbage that accumulates. So a definite need that we've seen, and an opportunity for us to kind of face-to-face interact with people who we've been writing to, or who maybe we've waved at as we walk by with our dog. So it's funny because I spend most of my days normally and my evenings very busy, and I don't spend a lot of time slowing down to just look around me. We've lived in this neighborhood for 8 years, and it's crazy how few of the people around me I actually know. So I am really thankful for this quarantine for that reason, and it's really making me reevaluate how I want to live my life after this ends, and you know, how it is that I connect with people around me even when we're not in this time of isolation. So really thankful that we've had chances to build this community during times of isolation and to bring people together during a time when it feels like the world is slowly pulling apart. Anyway, I hope you are all safe and healthy, and I will hope to see many of you in person very soon.
Hello, could you all introduce yourself?
Hello, I'm Dominic Moses.
And I'm Rhonda Moses.
Tell me where you grew up and where you went to school.
Well, I grew up here, over here on the west side of Indianapolis, on 33rd and Martha King, and I went to Barwick High School.
And I grew up on the west side of Indianapolis, on 31st in Clifton, and I went to Northwest High School.
I see on your shirts it says something, the Hamptons Academy Incorporated. Could you tell us what that is?
Well, the Hamptons Academy is a tribute to my family, the Hampton Sisters, the Hampton Family Band. We are in the Indianapolis Musicians Hall of Fame. We just want to bring light to helping the youth gain knowledge as far as acting, singing, dancing, performing arts training. And we also want to raise them with Christian-based learning system through our childcare. And we also do outreach throughout the community where we provide free wigs to cancer patients. We hold a curveball tournament every year annually. And we do a bail project where we help people who can't afford their bond, who have been given a bond through the courts, who can't afford their bonds to get released on the streets.
In fact, you've been trying to do something about that this week, haven't you?
Yes, yes. We have actually been trying to raise money to get an inmate out who has pre-existing conditions during this the COVID-19 pandemic. Mm-hmm.
And you put up some of your own money for this, right?
Yes, yes. We've actually put up more than $1,000 to several different inmates.
And one of your neighbors has also put up some money as well, right?
Yes, yes. The amount in the line entry.
So why this? Why bailing somebody out?
Well, we want to help the different families throughout the community who have, I guess, fallen on hard times, but have also had family members that made mistakes. Help them get back on the streets and help them become an asset to back to the community.
Why does that matter to you?
Well, it matters to me personally because I've actually been through it. I've actually made mistakes as a youth, got arrested, got out, got mentored, got the right treatment, started going to church, started volunteering, and I was able to change my life around. So I feel like if I'm able to do it, anybody can do it.
One of the things that we stand by is that this is God's mission. It's God's work, God's mission, and He's just using us as a vessel to be able to help His people.
So if people want to support you in this work, how could they do that?
Well, they could reach out to the Hamptons Academy at gmail.com, or they could get in contact with you, Mike, and let us know, you know, what they wanted to do or how they want to assist us.
Thank you so much. So in the scripture for this Sunday, it talks about the ways in which everybody was taking care of each other. I just want to say to the two of you, I see you living that out, what it says in the book of Acts about people taking care of one another. And I just want to say thank you.
Before we talk in today's homily, I'd love to share a poem with you. It's called God Our Mother, and it's written by Allison Woodward. To be a mother is to suffer, to travail in the dark, stretched and torn, exposed in half-naked humiliation, subjected to indignities for the sake of new life. To be a mother is to say, this is my body, broken for you. And in the next instant, in response to the created's primal hunger, this is my body, take and eat. To be a mother is to self-empty, to neither slumber nor sleep. So attuned you are to cries in the night, offering the comfort of yourself and assurances of, I'm here. To be a mother is to weep over the fighting and exclusions and wounds your children inflict on one another, to long for reconciliation and brotherly love, and, when all is said and done, to gather all parties, the offender and the offended, into the folds of your embrace, and to whisper in their ears that they are beloved. To be a mother is to be vulnerable, to be misunderstood, railed against, and blamed for the heartaches of the bewildered children who don't know where else to cast the angst they feel over their own existence in this perplexing universe. To be a mother is to hoist onto your hips those on whom your image is imprinted, bearing the burden of their weight, rejoicing in their returned affection, delighting in their wonder, bleeding in the presence of their pain. To be a mother is to be accused of sentimentality in one moment and injustice the next. To be the receiver of endless demands, absorber of perpetual complaints, reckoner of bottomless needs. To be a mother is to be an artist, a keeper of memories past, weaver of stories untold, visionary of lives looming ahead. To be a mother is to be the first voice listened to and the first disregarded. To be a mender of broken creations and comforter of the distraught children whose hands wrought them. To be a mother is to be a touchstone and the source, bestower of names, influencer of identities, life giver, life shaper, empath, healer, and original love. Amen. Let us pray together. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your eyes, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. On this day, Mother's Day, we honor our mothers, or those who have been like mothers to us. We honor and remember these folks, and we also remember those among us for whom this day may not be the easiest. We lift up those who have never had a mother, and we lift up mothers who have lost children, and those who have lost their mothers. We remember those with strained mother relationships, and remember mothers with strained child relationships. We honor those who have chosen not to be mothers, and we honor those who yearn or who have yearned to be mothers. When we think of a perfect mother or mother figure, we ought to think of God. After all, mothering attributes are not confined to any gender. God is compassionate and wise, standing in solidarity with us. God is sacrificial and wants the best for us. God is a gathering God, inviting those into community around a table that never stops giving and never stops growing. And God has tasked the church with being a mothering presence in the world today. We see an example of what the mothering presence of the church should be in Acts 2, 42 through 47. Words like empathetic, supportive, selfless, and nurturing come to mind. In this passage, we see the church listening to the teaching of the apostles and going to each other's houses for meals and fellowship. We see the church striving to care for one another in every need. No one went to bed hungry. Everyone had what they needed to live. No one had too much or too little. The church was compassionate, strong, loving, healing, and sacrificial. And the best part about it is noted in verse 47. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. People notice and respond when the church acts in the way God intends us to act. And so it continues to be with us today. On this Mother's Day in 2020, we are reminded of the suffering, the injustices, and the trauma in this world that must be addressed and responded to in a mothering way by gathering people into community to say, I'm here with you. I'm here for you. You don't have to be strong. You can let it all out. Today, we see and mourn with the families and communities of Ahmaud Arbery and Dreshawn Reed. We acknowledge and grieve our broken justice system, that the lives of these Black men have been taken away unjustly. Simultaneously, we grieve and denounce the fear, greed, apathy, and more that continue to drive our systems and devalue our Black and brown siblings. We grieve with those who have lost loved ones, family members, and friends due to these injustices and due to systemic incapacity with the coronavirus. We mourn our country's malevolent leadership and pray for hardened hearts to be softened and for justice to be restored. We need the mothering presence of God working through our church in the world now more than ever. Theologian N.T. Wright wrote that what you do in the present by painting, preaching, singing, sewing, praying, teaching, building hospitals, digging wells, campaigning for justice, writing poems, caring for the needy, loving your neighbor as yourself, these things will last into God's future. For such a time as this, I say, what we do in the present moment, by staying inside, by speaking out that Black lives still matter, by sewing masks, by freely sharing our assets and our money, by delivering groceries, by calling in and checking on our neighbors, by sending coffee to essential workers, by writing notes to teachers and doctors and nurses and grocery store workers. These things will last into God's future. These activities are not simply ways of making the present life a little less beastly, a little more bearable, until the day we leave it behind altogether. They are part of building God's kingdom. So let us do this holy, mothering, kingdom work together. Amen.
Every single day we pray. Sometimes out loud, sometimes with our bodies, sometimes with our breath, sometimes with our pain. Let us pray today, opening ourselves, our hearts, our spirits, our minds to the families of Ahmaud Arbery and Sean Reed, to those who share the same skin color, to those who share the same experience of being stared at, to those who share the same experience of being feared and hated, and for those who share the same desire to run free, for those who share the same desire to breathe easily, for those who share the same desire to live joyfully every single day. When we pray, we open ourselves to God and to one another. Always. Prayer isn't a time for us to ask something for God, to beg something for God, from God. It is a time for us to be aware that we are one with God and one with all creation. One with those who are different gender than I am. One with those who are different sexuality than I am. One with those who are a different ethnicity than I am, one with those who are from a different town or city or state or nation. It is a time when we are aware that we are all one in Christ. Every single day. Let us pray. Oh God, as my friend Harold Brown always reminds me, good mamas know this. On this Mother's Day, we seek to be comfort to those who mourn. For the family of John Gibson, for the family of Ahmaud Arbery, for the family of Sean Reed. Every single day. For those who every single day do not feel safe in the place they call home, whether in the house or on the street or in the park or on the porch. Every single day. For those who do not know they are beautiful because they have been hunted and harmed, beaten and barricaded, jailed and jerked around every single day. For those who are afraid to speak up, afraid to draw the ire of friends and families and coworkers every single day. For those who yearn to run and be free, to make mistakes and to live every single day. We offer all this and those prayers that have remained unspoken as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
It must have been cold there in my shadow. To never have sunlight on your face. You were content to let me shine. You always walked a step behind, while I was the one with all the glory. You were the one with all the strength. A beautiful face without a name. I never once heard you complain. Did you ever know that you're mine? Shiro, you're everything I would like to be. I can fly higher than an eagle. You are the wind beneath my wings. Might have appeared to go unnoticed. I've got it all right here in my heart. Ooh, I want you to know, I know the truth.
And let us together affirm our mission as we do every Sunday, reminding ourselves that the mission of Broadway is to be lived out outside of these walls as well as inside these walls. As followers of Jesus Christ, responding to God's love, our mission as the people of Broadway Church is to be a multicultural Christian community that in its ministry seeks, welcomes, and values all people.
Let us now go forth together with a benediction. God our Father, giver of daily bread, blessing our hands and covering our heads. God, our mother, leading us into peace, drawing and comforting all those in need. Hallowed, hallowed be thy name in all the earth. Be with us now and forevermore. Amen.